Okay, well, welcome to the penultimate in-person session of this Climate Capital live event. There's one more live or in-person session after this, and then we'll continue on our virtual platform before, of course, returning in person here at the Four Seasons tomorrow morning. So one of the hottest topics of conversation at the COP26 conference last November was climate finance. And the vast sums that developing countries in particular will need to deploy as they seek to respond to climate change. The International Energy Agency estimates that the developing world needs to invest more than $1 trillion a year in the transition to clean energy, and other estimates are even higher. And then there's the vast further amounts that these countries will need to spend to protect themselves and respond to the disastrous physical impacts of climate change. So it's clear that they're going to need substantial international financing to do all this through both the public and private sectors. But as it stands, we are not at all on track to mobilize funds at the scale required. So can we get there? And if so, how? To discuss that, I'm delighted to be joined by Stephanie von Friedeburg, who's the Senior Vice President of Operations at the International Finance Corporation. So, Stephanie, we were both at COP26. Mm-hmm. You know, it was an extraordinary event in many ways, in terms of its scale, in terms of the intensity of the conversation. One of the most interesting developments there was this very eye-catching announcement from GFANZ, the Glasgow Financial Alliance for Net Zero, which said that $130 trillion of private capital, private sector companies controlling that amount of assets, were mobilizing to do something about climate change. And yet that capital is not yet being deployed at that kind of scale. So what are the fundamental things that need to change in order to get there?
Great question, Simon. So first, it's really great to be here. It's great to see people three-dimensionally. That was one of my first takeaways from COP26, actually, is that people were physically together. So I'm glad we're able to do that. Maybe I'll take a step back. I think you started to frame it really well, but I would add maybe a little bit more to that. So greening the global economy is a massive undertaking, a scale we've never seen across anything we've ever tried to do. And we've all kind of known that, but you know, McKinsey recently did this study where they said $9.2 trillion a year between now and 2050. And there's a gap of $3.5 trillion a year already. And we know from COVID that there's no fiscal space left. There's none. I mean, if you look around the globe, even in the developed world, the fiscal space to get this done in the public sector doesn't exist. And it's gotten even smaller because of COVID. And yet everybody says, oh, this is a great economic opportunity. We ourselves, our own data says, in the 21 biggest emerging markets, $10 trillion opportunity between now and 2030. But there are massive barriers to making that happen. And I would really say there are three. So first, there's not enough projects out there for all of us to work on. And everybody thinks that there's massive numbers of projects. Honestly, they're not there. Second, if you look at the investable capital that everybody keeps talking about moving into all of these projects, it's teachers and nurses' pensions. It's all regulated in the markets from which it comes. And they can't invest. So if I were to say, come with me and invest in the Democratic Republic of Congo, I've got a great solar project, none of them could come with me. And so we've got to be able to overcome that barrier. It's a very fundamental barrier. And then thirdly, in addition to kind of there's a risk-return trade-off that doesn't fit together for most of these investors. So I actually believe that organizations like IFC and the other international financial institutions need to be that bridge between the public and the private and the desire to bring as much of that institutional money in as possible. So we have to work what we call working upstream, which is actually we've deployed almost 300 people to creating projects, so working as project developers so that we can bring more institutional investors with us. The second thing I think we all need to do is think about how do we actually use blended finance to de-risk some of these projects in a way that make them better or make them bankable for an institutional investor. And the third thing is we need to create more platforms that actually pool assets so that we create diversified risk that can be rated or shadow rated. And that will really allow us to entice these investors to come with us.
Right. I think a lot of analysis when it comes to blended finance focuses on this issue of fragmentation. Mm-hmm. So you have a problem of huge diversity of different sorts of projects that are very difficult to analyze on an ad hoc basis. And also they're often too small for a lot of investors to really be able to get involved with them. So what's the answer to that from a practical point of view?
So I actually believe that blended finance is one of the critical solutions. We need blended finance to fix policy and regulatory issues, or at least de-risk projects for policy and regulatory issues in many of these markets, to buy down the cost of technology. I mean, some of these technologies that we want to, you and I have been talking about some of them already, they're too expensive for emerging markets. And so just take the example of solar. When we started to invest in solar, 25 cents a kilowatt hour, with blended finance and moving massive amounts of solar projects around the world, we've done auctions lately for under 2.5 cents. But that took us 10, 15 years. We don't have that much time. So we need to find a way to buy down the cost of capital, for sure. Blended finance can help us do that. But again, I think we're going to have to think super creatively, and you're going to need the likes of international finance institutions like ours, because we bring a level of credibility so that we don't greenwash, we don't whitewash, and we don't actually misuse public money. Because remember, what we're going to be doing that blending with is public money, and there's not enough of it to go around.
I want to come back to a point that you raised earlier on about investing in a country like the Democratic Republic of Congo, where the institutions are not as strong as they are in other countries, and where many investors would have concerns about integrity of contracts and so on. Is there a way around this? And can the IFC play a role in helping to provide that security for private sector investors somehow?
So this is actually what we do. This is our bread and butter. But in a place like the Democratic Republic of Congo, when you're looking at the sanctity of contract, you also can use the different pieces of the World Bank Group balance sheet. So remember, we're made up of IBRD, IDA, IFC, MIGA, and we each play different roles in the development landscape. So one of the things that we've started to do substantially more of is partner with the World Bank. So I could actually invest in a solar park that has a PPA with the government. I'm not convinced that the off-taker has enough capacity, either technical capacity or financial capacity, to actually honor that contract. A partial risk guarantee from the World Bank actually puts the government on the hook to ensure that my investment gets paid. Great way to de-risk projects. We use it a lot in emerging markets, in Africa in particular. We actually have a very special piece of the IDA balance sheet, which allows us to do this as grant funding as well.
One of the issues with blended finance, as it's been around for a long time, as you said, but it's become a particularly hot topic of late. And one sort of area of controversy is this sort of moral hazard argument, this idea that fat cats on Wall Street get to pick up the profits and organizations that are funded by taxpayers are on the hook for the losses. Do you think there's anything that needs to be done or could be done in terms of the structure of the work that's being done to address that? Or do you think this is fundamentally a communication problem, that the message needs to get across better how impactful this kind of work can be?
So, Simon, I think it's more than a communication problem. And I've had many conversations with top quartile PE firms that say, well, we'll come to Africa with you as long as my return is X, and that return is 35%, which means blended finance to actually enhance the yield of those investors. I don't think that's the purpose of blended finance. The purpose is really to make a project bankable, to pull out enough risk that it's not just my balance sheet, but it's the balance sheet of private sector investors, other private sector investors, that help us get there. So least cost subsidies matter. Auctions matter. Anytime you can do any of those things along the way, you actually make it a very transparent process. And again, the IFIs can really lead in that. One of the things that we've used blended finance for is not just buying down interest rates, but actually layering first loss into different structures. So we created something called MCPP, which is a mobilization platform. We've raised $10 billion. Actually, at COP, we announced a new MCPP we call One Planet, where HKMA and Allianz have come with us for $3 billion. But there's a small layer of Swedish donor money in there that actually compensates them, that makes the pooled assets that we put onto that platform triple B or better. And that's the differential. And that's all we need, just enough to get them bumped into a, at least a shadow rating that makes it acceptable. Again, teachers and nurses' pensions. So it's some combination there.
One of the things I wanted to mention was following on from the IPCC report that, that came out last week, which talked a lot about the challenges of adaptation. And when we look at how climate finance has been deployed, it's generally been deployed for mitigation, for clean energy projects and this sort of thing. And it might seem obvious why. I mean, these things generate returns in a way that, you know, a seawall, for example, or a relocation project wouldn't. But do you think there are ways that we can be more creative, that the, you know, organizations like the IFC can be more creative to mobilize capital for adaptation as well, because so much is needed there?
Absolutely, Simon. And I actually think about this two separate ways. So company and country. At the company level, it's basic risk mitigation to screen any asset, at least in our countries of operation, for adaptation risk. If you're not doing that, you're not a good investor. So if we're going to build a school, and it's going to be in low-lying ground and it's going to be underwater in 5 years, I've made the wrong choice of the asset that I'm investing in. And I could go on and on about other examples, but agribusiness projects, all sorts of things. We have to screen all of those for climate adaptation risk. And my view is, again, thinking about blended finance, build into the project cost the additional cost for that adaptation investment. And then we help fund it. And we might need some donor funding to make that happen. But at least we build assets that we know will not be stranded. Then at the country level, we need to work very closely with our World Bank colleagues. We need to think about national, state, and municipal policies and plans that are very well thought through. And then I believe we can use public-private partnerships and auction those to actually bring more private money to the places where those adaptation investments will make sense. We just did a really interesting sustainable bond with the city of Izmir, where we helped them with their water utility restructure so they're actually using water better and cleaning out their canals. And again, totally an adaptation project, but very interesting.
Fantastic. Green bonds, another thing that we must not miss the opportunity to talk about. The IFC has been something of a pioneer in this field. Last year, green bonds globally over $500 billion of issuance, and that's set to rise much further in the years to come. But there's still a lot of skepticism in many quarters about what the proceeds of these bonds are actually used for. What's the answer to that? How are we going to get really standards in place that are really widely trusted by the whole market?
So first, we actually think the market's going to be $1 trillion in 2022, half of which will be in emerging markets. Big opportunity for us. And honestly, Simon, we've come a long way. I actually think the international principles that have been created and followed for green bonds do a really good job. Now, it doesn't mean that every single jurisdiction in which we invest is following them, but our job is to go and make sure that the companies that we work with issue green bonds to international standards. Great example are a couple of green bonds that we've issued in China, where we've said to the Chinese company, Chinese regulation is here, we want you to be here. Come with us and come all the way up here. Makes a big difference. And, you know, we have done a lot of green bonds ourselves. Since 2010, over $10 billion of green bonds, 175 issuances, and they fund a plethora of projects that actually help us make the environment better. My focus actually is less on green bonds, and it's more on the rest of the rainbow. So we have pink bonds, we have white bonds, we have blue bonds, we have sustainability bonds. None of those have the same policy and regulatory frameworks that have been developed for green. We need to get there, because I actually think that's where the washing is going to take place.
We have a couple of questions from the digital audience that I'll throw at least one of them to you now. Let's see. City mayors have stated they want to tackle air pollution in their cities, but they can't get the finance. Surely cities are an obvious starting point for these sorts of projects. Do you think there's enough focus on the city level when it comes to financing?
Not yet, but we're certainly working on it in emerging markets. And we actually have a fairly large municipals business. And what we've tried to do actually is, again, thinking of World Bank Group, divide municipalities, which ones are actually bankable from a private perspective. So who can we help issue bonds? Who can we do financing for that can be private sector led and we can actually lead syndications? We've done a lot of really interesting work in Argentina, Colombia. We actually built the cable in Argentina, which actually takes people into the poor areas in the hills so that it's much cleaner and it's a faster way to get home, get to and from work. Done a lot in Turkey as well. And actually with the city of Izmir, we've spent 10 years helping them plan urbanization. What does that mean in terms of urban transport? What does it mean in terms of green buildings? You know, how do you build all of that out? And we actually have a really interesting tool now that takes a lot of the work that we've done with green buildings and converts it to cities so the cities can actually see where are they making progress and where aren't they making progress. Again, going back to this idea that everybody needs to plan.
Absolutely. I think we have time for one question from the audience before we wrap up, if anybody has anything they're burning to ask.
Thank you very much for a wonderful presentation. Regarding the first loss mitigation, I think you're talking about that you got from the Swedish, was it an Investa? Mm-hmm. What is the cost of that? I don't know if that's the right question, but how does it work? How much does the project need to pay to get that kind of first loss?
So the project doesn't pay for the first loss. In essence, what we do is we put a piece of donor money into a structure that's first loss, it goes first, and then typically we put a junior tranche and then a senior tranche, and we take a piece of the junior tranche. The yield on that anywhere probably between 10 and 20%, depending upon what we're doing. And then the senior piece is a very well-structured piece at the top that most of the institutional investors and even retail investors can take. So, you know, the example I would give you, so we work very closely with certain fund managers. Amundi happens to be one, and we did something called the EGO Fund. The reason why I love this structure is first loss, junior tranche that we, EIB and EBRD took, senior tranche. But the beauty of working with a firm like Amundi is we actually create the bonds with our companies in different markets. They bring the retail investors. So they can actually bring, you know, a Belgian dentist into our structure because of the nature of what they do. So again, it's how do you open that aperture for different kinds of investors and pull that money into emerging markets?
Thank you so much, Stephanie, for some wonderful insights. I think
good
we've all learned a lot. Thank you. So everyone, please do stick around for our next session, which will deal with the question of what is the role of private equity in decarbonization, moderated by my colleague, Polita Clark. So please do stick around for that. We'll look forward to seeing you there in a few minutes.